is called, would offering a price tag on bodily organs help to alleviate the organ shortage crisis? Dr. Andrew Flescher is our presenter. Dr. Flescher, PhD, is a professor of family, population, and preventative medicine and professor of English at State University of New York, Stony Brook, where he is also core faculty in the program in public health. Dr. Flescher serves on Stony Brook's Organ Donor Council and Hospital Ethics Committee and is a living donor advocate at Stony Brook Hospital. Dr. Flescher specializes in healthcare policy, organ donation policy, and medical and bioethics, as well as in areas related to the interface between ethics and literature. Dr. Flescher received his BA in Medieval and Renaissance Studies and History from Duke University in 1991, and his MA in 1995, and PhD in 2000 in Religious Studies from Brown University. In addition to writing several articles and book chapters, he is also the author of four books, Heroes, Saints, and Ordinary Morality, The Altruistic Species, winner of the Choice Award, Moral Evil, winner of the Prose Award, and most recently, The Organ Shortage Crisis in America. And is that the one that will, which will be sold at the end of today's platform? Dr. Flescher joined the Ethics Committee of UNOS, the United Network for Organ Sharing, and he has also recently been appointed to Live on New York's Ethics Committee. Additionally, Dr. Flescher is on the board of the Gingold Theatrical Group in New York City, dedicated to fighting for human, women's, and animal rights through presenting the work and wit of George Bernard Shaw. He plays piano occasionally in the Stony Brook Hospital lobby for patients, their families, and staff. Please welcome Dr. Andrew Flescher.
Thank you so much for a warm introduction such as that. I'm humbled, and it's even more humbling to be before the New York Society for Ethical Culture. I went into this getting a PhD because I'm committed to social justice, but the way in which social justice is procured is often debated. I like to tell people, as a medical ethicist, our first order of business is always to provide as much comfort as we can to the afflicted, wherever you find them. But shortly after that, it's about providing affliction to the comfortable, which is to say, hopefully today there'll be occasion to think about things. These are what I like to tell my students. Non-no-brainer issues, which means intelligent people can be on both sides. And I'm motivated by this specific question that I ask in the book and that we'll be discussing today. It's on the one hand a question of how we can immediately attend to those 120,000 people in the United States of America. It's down to about 115,000 now, but when I wrote the book it was 120. Who are in desperate need of an organ, most of which need a kidney. So I term this in the book an especially precious good, a good that's non-replenishable, a good that has a magnificent benefit if that good is transferred from one individual to another. But in another sense, in a broader sense, bodily organs are a species of the larger genus of especially precious goods. So what I'm really interested in is, what motivates people to do wonderful things for other people, and would money hurt or help the cause? So you could suggest that with regard to this class of goods, not everything, but this class of goods, especially precious goods, of which a bodily organ is one. The book is also a referendum on the limits of capitalism as a motivating system for solving problems of social justice. So I'm sure there'll be a diversity of opinions with regard to where I'm going, but I'm certainly honored to be here because the purview of this society is one which asks just these kinds of questions. For 20 years, the gap has been growing. This is, of course, a quote from Dickens, my favorite Dickens book, A Tale of Two Cities. It was the best of times and the worst of times. And the reason that that's quoted, that was actually Dr. Amy Freeman invoking Dickens. I debated her on television in 2011. Amy is the medical director for Live On New York, on whose ethics board I sit. She's vociferously in favor of allowing for the sale of organs, and she cited Dickens to say we have wonderful... That we have wonderful technology available to us. This is timely. We have wonderful technology available to us to facilitate transplantation, but as seatbelts become more safe and cars become safer themselves, and the traffic tickets for not wearing your seatbelt become higher and more enforced, and people are living longer, cadaveric donation is not what it used to be in terms of providing a source for procuring those organs. And so that puts an extra burden on living donation. So her argument is that it's a real shame that we are not doing everything we possibly could to motivate potential givers. This gap has been growing. It peaked roughly in 2016 at 125,000, and now it's down to 115,000. The slight gap, although it's starting to go up again, is number one, there are new drugs now to treat hepatitis. I don't know if you heard in the news, but at the University of Pennsylvania, a year and a half ago, 10 individuals who were tested positive for hepatitis gave their kidney to 10 recipients. All 10 caught hepatitis, and then were, had a new organ and were cured of hepatitis. It was done on purpose. It was a beautiful thing. They knew that they could cure the hepatitis with these new drugs. So really, we don't need livers the way that we quite used to. There are still some cases where we do. And also, there's a little bit more accuracy with respect to how people on the waiting list are counted. But there's still 115,000 to 120,000 people who need an organ. And all of these individuals are desperate to get that organ. And when you're somebody who needs an organ and on dialysis, and dialysis has a lifespan during which it's effective, I know this because I got into this sitting with my uncle who was on dialysis. He suffered from diabetes type 1 before he passed away. Everything. The goal here is not just mere survival, but not just mere life, but living, to circulate an individual back into the workforce. Just some statistics that I like to present to an audience that's not steeped in this stuff every day. I discussed the first one. At least 100,000 to about 102,000 of that 115,000 are waiting for a kidney. And this is significant because a kidney, along with your lobe of the liver, is the only thing a living person can give. Obviously, a living person can't give a lung or a heart. Is that good? I guess that's better. Okay, I'll try to speak in here. So I'm an advocate for as is Amy Freeman, who I debated, I'm an advocate for trying to increase the maximum amount of people that we can to serve as donors. 20 people die each day waiting for transplants. Every 10 minutes, a new name's added to the list. One deceased donor, this is in case of cadaveric donation, can give up to 8 organs. About 15,000 transplanted organs per year, resulting in 31,000 transplants, again, most of which are kidney transplants. And there's a wonderful success rate with regard to kidney transplants, even a little better if those come from actual living donors. And the reason for this is that there's a nice transition from dialysis to donation. You can time things a little bit better if it's planned. And comparing dialysis to someone who's got a transplanted organ, if you have a transplantation that's about $80,000 to $90,000, in year two, dialysis is about $80,000 to $90,000 a year. A transplantation is about $120,000. In year two, economically, it makes most sense to have someone have a transplanted organ than to have that person continue on dialysis. So it's, in terms of allocating scarce resources, more equitable for society. And if you have a living donor, there's what's known as less ischemic time. So the organ in question is not going to metabolize so fast that organ becomes so unusable due to warmth, which is why when an organ gets procured from a body, it's put on a tray of ice and then immediately ferried into the adjacent OR to get retransplanted. Living donation is much easier now because of laparoscopic, which is camera-assisted and mini-nephrectomy, smaller incision surgery. I counsel about 40 living donors per year as a living donor advocate, which means I assure my hospital and get assurance from them that this is a free, consenting kind of activity. I talk about some of the consequences, of which there are very, very little post 2 weeks, but I inform them as to what getting a transplantation and having a nephrectomy is like. And, you know, very cautious and conservative with regard to this process for the sake of ensuring integrity throughout it. Now, it is a costly thing to give one's kidney to get. I watched a nephrectomy. I scrubbed into the OR. It takes about 4 hours to actually take that kidney, the first 3 hours of which are very carefully cutting through layers of fat, and then the last 45 minutes to an hour, you cut off the veins. I don't want to get too specific. It's very safe. I've never seen anything go wrong. At Stony Brook, I've never heard of anything going wrong. But it's costly when you cut through layers of fat to get to a kidney, which is, relatively speaking, pretty hard to get to. So these days, a lot of transplant surgeons, some libertarians think, you know, there are other people in this process benefiting, not the least of which is the recipient. Why shouldn't the donor, him or herself, also benefit? So, you know, this shortage is especially disconcerting that given that since organ transplantation became sound medical treatment, we've never had better technology, while so little occasion to avail ourselves of it. In response to the crisis, transplant surgeons and economists alike have begun to furnish novel, compelling arguments for legalizing the sale of organs among living donors to provide incentives for increasing the available pool. And this is Dr. Amy Friedman, which we were debated in 2011. It's time to cease to be satisfied with waiting for dignity for the organ that never comes. So she was challenging the notion that there's something noble about just giving without the expectation of a tangible gift in return. Now, I always tell my students, it's whenever you have a position, it's good to think about what the very, very intelligent people in the other side of your position happen to say themselves. And there's three strong reasons why one might want to legalize the sale of organs and subject this to the open market. First of all, there's a black market, and the black market's very dangerous. In China, up until 2010, Falun Gong prisoners were involuntarily having their organs extracted, and they were being sold on the open market. Black markets deal with all sorts of conflict types of situations. Presumably, if the sale of organs were legal, it would be a highly regulated, transparent market, and we could, you know, be relatively assured that there would be no kinds of gross violations of human rights. Also, there's an equity question. The person who's in favor of selling organs alleges we pay sperm and egg donors, we pay surrogates for their sacrifice. When you carry a baby to term for 9 months, certainly don't think myself that that's any less of a burden on the surrogate in that case than it would be on the person giving an organ to another. Our society allows us to pay surrogates. Why wouldn't we comparably allow for people to be paid for the kidney donation? You could even argue that that's more onerous. We pay people that serve in our armed services. Why not also, non-paternalistically treat people in a position to make a decision as adults? It's their decision to make. Mark Cherry, who actually published with the same press, he wrote a book called Kidney for Sale by Owner. Our books were treated in a review as sort of the two sides of this coin, and they were both put out by Georgetown University Press, which is known for its work in bioethics. That's a tough kind of objection to answer. I address it in the book. I do think there's a difference between egg and sperm on the one hand, which carries the presumption of anonymity. Mostly people who are sperm donors don't want to be known as such. Whereas, in contrast, people who donate their organs, and I've gotten to see this up close as a living donor advocate, very much want not to be anonymous. They want their recipient to know them. They want to get to know the recipient and the recipient's family. So I'm the first to agree with Amy Friedman that the donor is not just a pure automaton, a pure altruist, without any expectation of self-regard. However, That self-regard is in the beautiful moment of getting to know the recipient, in the beautiful moment of creating a wider community. So we both agree that compensation is something that a donor would rightly expect. We just disagree about whether and the extent to which money makes the world go round as that form of compensation. And then finally, the question that I ask in the book, and I'll get into the specifics in a little bit, it's an interesting kind of question, is would this actually work? If you put a price tag on organs, what would likely happen? Would you have more or less? And would some people be scared off now who would have otherwise given their organ freely because other people are getting paid? This, of course, has never been evaluated because it's always been illegal ever since 1984. NOTA, which is the law that governs the guidelines for how organ transplantation could take place, specified right at the outset that it would be illegal to put a price tag or even have something of comparable value in exchange for giving one's organ. In fact, the only country in the world where it is legal to sell one's organ is Iran. China was the most recent in 2010, and the most prevalent place where this took place was India. It became illegal actually in the 90s to sell your organ in India. And it's from India that we have the most reliable studies. This is the book. It's for sale at a reduced price if you're so inclined afterwards to buy it. It's on the table. Talk to Haley, who's my fiance and in the audience here. Couple questions that I ask in the book. First of all, how should we address this crisis? Would legalizing the sale of organs, besides certain ethical misgivings, which I'll briefly mention, actually get us more organs? And then the second question is the one I mentioned earlier about capitalism. What are the limitations of capitalism as a motivating economic structure when it comes to this specific class of goods, which I call especially precious goods? So I'm not, you know, arguing for the undoing of capitalism when it comes to selling cars, or when it comes to selling plainly tangible kinds of items. But I do have some questions about it when it comes to quote the commercial, the things that are priceless, the things that money cannot buy. First of all, some of those ethical issues, I think in good faith, a lot of these can be answered now, but they're the traditional kinds of objections that bioethicists have dealt with in terms of rejecting the idea of selling organs. This is not new work. I deal with all of these in one chapter in the book because I think it's important to inform the audience as to what sort of the ubiquitous kinds of objections are to putting a price tag on things. One kind of objection is that it's not exactly fair to the poor. Another one is commodification. I'll explain what that is, but it's sort of making the so-called or presumably sacred mundane. And then finally, there's some safety questions. So first, the idea of exploiting the impoverished. These are actual pictures of individuals in debt, all of whom lined up legally to give their kidney. It was legal in India until 1994 and legal in the Philippines until slightly later. It's illegal in both places now. But literally, you would see mechanisms for people in need, often in debt, targeted to give their organs. A person with whom I serve on UNOS's National Ethics Committee, really a mentor of mine, he's brilliant, a guy named Bob Veach, wrote in Transplantation Ethics, he actually construed the selling of organs as a way for people to emerge from poverty. So his thesis was legalizing the sale of organs as potentially exploitative in conditions of irredeemable poverty. However, in a place like the United States, we have the means through regulation and other instruments of justice to eliminate disparity, and for whatever reason we culpably haven't yet done so. So we can't rule out this mechanism in principle for leveling the playing field. So it's reasonable to wager that practically speaking, allowing for the sale of organs would eliminate rather than contribute to economic disparity. So the concern is that legalizing the sale of organs, you're going to have, and I'll get to this, rich people walking around with poor people's organs. Veach says, au contraire, that actually this is a way of leveling the playing field and solving the organ shortage crisis at once. Well, this was tested by a number of studies that emerged out of India mostly, but also a final one out of Iran where it still is legal. And I will send anybody here the footnotes for this if I'm going a little too fast. But the upshot of this slide is basically that those who sold their kidney to get out of debt were almost immediately back in debt and worse off than when before when they had two kidneys. This last study was a little bit of a different kind of investigation, and it showed that in Iran, kidney sellers had extreme shame. This guy Zarghouti had to leave Iran after he published this. So the idea here is that it's a good approach in theory, but practically it doesn't work because there are, as you know better than anyone by virtue of being in this society, underlying conditions, much bigger macro conditions that lead more institutional kinds of things that lead one to be susceptible to being in debt in the first place. That there's no quick fix to this, and that there's something unseemly about exploiting those already poorly off by dangling a short-term fix. But, you know, I think it was mentioned that I'm both a professor of English and a professor of bioethics. It's weird, sometimes I have these two existences in teaching completely different kinds of courses. But to the extent that I can, I always like to bring beautiful scenarios from literature into my discussion of bioethics. Are there any Ursula Le Guin readers in the audience? She's one of my, I'm glad to see a couple. She is a brilliant short story writer. She uses science fiction as a way to probe some of our, you know, humanistic kinds of salient problems. This is a story about children trapped in a basement, suffering immeasurably in a basement. And this is a beautiful town that needs nothing. It's like a Garden of Eden. But for reasons that are not completely explained, that they're not totally understood, in this basement, the suffering of these children leads to the well-being and flourishing of everyone else. And every year at about, you know, it, spring or so, 13, 14-year-olds have to go and witness these children in the basement and agree to this consequence of their happiness. And there's a small percentage, about 10%, that can't, you know, abide. They're the ones who walk away from a malice. So to me, as much of an advocate as I am for organ donation, I wouldn't want to abide a society in which ultimately the wealthy walked around with the impoverished people's organs. And this was asked to me before the talk. It's estimated due to black market projections that a kidney would go for about $150,000. So think about who could pay for that. Another kind of misgiving is commodification. I won't spend too much time here, but this is the idea that commodification is a process where markets reduce different ways of valuing things to one dimension measured in money, which leads to the debasement of that good. For example, in buying an academic degree or buying a friend or giving a eulogy and passing it off as your own writing, something that's supposed to be very intimate and personal. If it were ever to be learned that that was written by somebody else, it would reveal you as a fraud on the spot. I think this is behind the Beatles song, Can't Buy Me Love, and so you can't. The idea here is that a kidney is not just a kidney. A kidney is also a means by which individuals establish social relations in society. It may work to sell a kidney if we were only talking about one seller and one buyer, and not future sellers and buyers. But the minute a precious good is commodified, all of a sudden the means by which motivation would be affected by third parties ramifies. All of a sudden, the person down the road who might be considered an organ donor, all of a sudden that person now is thinking in terms of dollars and cents. And the question is, what happens to the brain in psychology when that takes place? So I'm interested in the book in both the religious kinds of resistances to assuming dominion over that which is God's, for those who have a theological perspective, but also a more secular objection based on commodification that especially precious goods, just by their nature, resist financial compensation. And so there are special constraints on this market for this kind of good. The gift of life is not only a tangible material gift, Altering the way in which an organ is freely given as a gift affects the way in which the exchange of this precious good preserves the communal values in which that exchange takes place. So cash incentive alters, if not the good itself, the function of this good. So that's an academic way of basically putting the point that when we put a price tag on things, we actually change who we are in a society, which will have consequences with regard to some types of things more than others. And this woman, Margaret Jane Radden, a philosopher, wrote a book just about this notion called Contested Commodities. The very things which, if you put a price tag on them, you don't just alter the exchange of those goods, but also the conditions of the society in which you live. And then finally, there's a history of putting a price tag on things affecting the safety of those things. This was a case from 2011 from the Hunan province in China, where a teen sold an organ for an iPad and then had complications resulting. There's a long-standing, rich tradition in medical ethics of paternalism, where we're meant to help people, even if they themselves make a decision to the contrary. And even in our own history, I don't know, this is a little known fact, it was legal to sell blood in this country from 1946 to 1968. And in those 22 years, there was a guy named Richard Titmuss who wrote a book called The Gift Exchange and compared blood rates of donors in the United States, where it was legal to sell blood and be paid, against those in England and Wales where it was illegal. Not only did he find that in England and Wales, more people signed up to be blood donors, and today we really don't have, for the most part, a blood shortage problem, not the way we have an organ shortage problem, but actually the blood that was accrued from voluntary giving was much safer, much less susceptible to high risk and disease than those procured through selling. So, these are some safety issues. I think that this objection can be overcome today because testing has become so sophisticated. And I already told you that account from the University of Pennsylvania where people were deliberately giving kidneys with hepatitis. The kidneys worked perfectly fine. Those individuals caught hepatitis. It was predicted that they would. And a few months later, they were all 10 for 10 hepatitis free. Safety isn't so much an issue, but still human beings, there's human error. Human beings are overseeing the conducting of these tests. And if you're eliciting deliberately people to sell organs to get paid, you are opening yourself up to that risk. But the bigger question that I'm interested in, and the one in which I debated with Amy Friedman, was this question about what the nature of compensation is that will most motivate people, and whether or not, if you've got two kind of examples for that, altruism versus getting paid, they also stand in tension with one another. I argue that they're different, that one's more powerful than the other, and if you have both, one will undermine the other. So, to put this to a point, in the case of precious or non-material goods, money, I argue, doesn't afford the giver the same motivational push or sense of internal satisfaction he or she gets when giving from a sense of civic duty. The minute a price tag is put on something, you are depriving, I argue, that individual of the ability to form the kind of identity that he or she might want to be connected to a society in a profound way. I've gone a little rapidly to pause for a second here. I said earlier, there's no, at the moment, means of directly testing this because it's legal to sell organs in this country. But these are some very interesting analogous cases. I already brought up the case of Titmuss, where you counterintuitively got better participation when blood wasn't for sale. But this second case, Wolf and Schiess in Switzerland, I don't know if you know this, but the Swiss are a very transparent people. And relative to the rest of the world, the Swiss rank only behind the French in terms of using nuclear energy to power their electricity. Well, when you use nuclear energy, you have to find a place to house nuclear waste. So this is a problem for those that rely heavily on nuclear energy. What the Swiss government did was they contacted all the people that lived near this town, Wolf and Schiess in Switzerland. There was this mountain near the town. And they showed ample evidence to suggest if we put our nuclear waste in this mountain, you're going to be fine, okay? But we don't feel comfortable doing it without telling you. So they wrote letters to all the adults roughly 8,000 families, and with each case gave respondents the opportunity to say, are you okay with what we're about to do? And they got the results back. Did anyone want to guess what that result was? What percentage of people told that there would be nuclear waste housed in a nearby mountain, but that it was totally safe? What percentage of people were okay with that? Does anyone want to?
90%.
What was your answer?
90.
Wow, that is an unbelievably charitable account of the Swiss people. I usually get lower answers, but that's a good guess. Other
20%.
20?
10.
Others? I mean, all legitimate guesses, and I love where you were going. And the answer is about half, 50.8%. But that's not the really interesting thing. So, God bless the Swiss. That wasn't good enough. 50.8% was not good enough for the Swiss government. So what they did was they offered a sweetener in increments of what would be comparable to $2,000, up to $8,000. So they offered $2,000, then they offered $4,000, they offered $6,000, they offered $8,000. What do you think happened when they offered $2,000? Just a mere $2,000. Less than half, 24.8%. From 50.8 to 24.8. And then when they offered the increments of 2,000 up to 8,000, exactly one person changed his mind. Once a commodity, always a commodity. So it turns out there's been a lot of psychologists that I don't have the time to go into, but they're footnoted in the book, that talk about what happens to the brain when money is offered. Number one, it awakens a disposition of mistrust. Number two, it turns out, and I don't completely understand this, that it's sort of like an addictive thing. It's like what happens in a casino or when you're giving cocaine or, you know, a number of other kinds of addictive types of things. There is a profound difference, I argue, on some of these boards between making organ donation something that's cost neutral, which is to say removing the disincentives to donate. If someone has to travel to donate, you know, I think we should compensate those people. That hasn't gotten out of committee in most states, including New York. There was a bill proposed in 2007. And on the other hand, offering them a lump sum, even though clearly no one disagrees they're making a great sacrifice. And then just a couple other examples. These come from a book written by a colleague of mine, Michael Sandel, at Harvard, the title of which is What Money Can't Buy. A couple examples out of Israel. One is a daycare center, and one is teenage charity collectors. There's a daycare center. Israel has a very good domestic set of policies that are collectivist. So, you know, very good daycare in Israel. I just state that forthrightly. But there was a problem in that people were picking up their kids later and later and later and later. So the daycare started to fine offenders for being late. What do you think happened? Even later. I'm paying for it. Might as well get the most for it. Charity collectors in Israel, this is as well. Three classes of individuals. The teenagers, I think they were Girl Scouts, or the older version of Girl Scouts, collecting for a valuable charity and getting none of the commission. Then collectors who got 10% of the commission, and then ones who got 3% of the commission. Who do you think was the most successful? They went to the same kinds of houses, same amount of time, same opportunity to exert effort on behalf of the common good. Which group did exactly? The first did the best. Second best, though, was the one that were getting set 10% of the commission. And way, way, way behind at the end were just 2 to 3%. Point being, there's an article written by the guy named Bruno Frey. He's listed there. Bruno Frey wrote about, he had about seven different articles. This one is The Old Lady Visits Your Backyard, A Tale of Morals and Markets. So there's a whole kind of series of economic questions, not in my backyard, right? Nuclear waste near where I live. Well, one of his articles was titled, Pay a Lot or Don't Pay at All. And now we're right back to Amelis. I'm even willing to concede that you go above that 150,000, let's say up to 250,000, you're gonna get your kidneys, but then what kind of society are we living in? So some conclusions I draw in the book, number one, allowing the sale of organs among living donors will have a negative impact on the organ donor network's attempt to recruit cadaveric donors. So not only are you going to crowd out those who would have been living donors, you're going to cast aspersions on whether or not people actually sign up to be organ donors on your license. I mean, I'm an organ donor, you can see with the heart, but that means technically that if something happens to me, then my organs can be used. Turns out, we know this through studies, if we were to allow for organs to be sold, that would, according to the market research that has been done, negatively impact the amount of people who signed up and registered to be organ donors. Incidentally, I'm going to say this, I think it's an appropriate place to say it, the New York Society for Ethical Culture, New York ranks last, 50th out of 50, in terms of people who register to become organ donors. I think everyone should. I can talk about that after if you wish. But putting a price tag wouldn't help the matter. Also, markets reduce the activity of transferring goods to an individualized contractual experience. So this is what I said, once a commodity, always a commodity. It really does matter that this is principally a non-anonymous activity. Once, I have about 40 a year and I've been doing this for about 6 years. So, you know, over 200 people I've had hour-long interviews with as they are poised to become organ donors. In one case only did that individual who was gonna give his or her organ wish to remain anonymous. Now, they give me all the tough cases at Stony Brook. So I get all the people that are so-called altruistic donors, which is a technical term. An organ donation means you're giving to someone who you don't know, not a family member, not a dear friend. It's not directed donation, which is to say it's not designated for a specific individual. You walk in and you're going to help out the world by giving your kidney. Even with regard to those altruistic donors, only one time ever, did I meet someone who didn't want to be known. I have never met a sperm donor. I don't know a lot to begin with, but I've never met somebody who discusses egg and sperm donation in a way in which they want their identities anything other than anonymous. That's important because part of the compensation here, I don't disagree that people expect something in return. I don't think altruism is the opposite of self-interest. I happen to think they work together. To invoke a philosopher, Immanuel Kant, I don't believe that altruism and selflessness always need to be purified of self-interest. But that payoff is in terms of social cohesion. And finally, sort of a subtle point, financial exchanges in this world are always between more than two parties, even though they can straightforwardly come across as being between two parties, because people are aware of what was done before them. So if the going rate of a kidney is 150,000, or the going rate of a cadaveric kidney is 50,000, imagine a young couple who just tragically lost their child. Now they're being able to be paid off for that loss with 50,000. I think that kind of projected compensation is so crass in the way that it's presented, even if it's using the most deferential, user-friendly kind of language, that you will hurt the cause overall. So does this mean I'm suggesting self-regarding incentives? Does this mean I'm suggesting no self-regarding incentives for becoming a donor? No. The self-regarding incentives, however, are not financial. And I'm very much in favor of other sorts of incentives. Just to mention a couple, I don't know if any of you read a New York Times article that came out about 2 years ago. 60 people involved in a chain, one pure donor, one pure recipient, and everybody else giving for their loved one, where if they weren't a match, there was another person designated who was, and these were, you know, big chains. A smaller chain is called a paired exchange. It's usually between two couples or three couples of individuals, and that's a way to overcome the problem of not matching. Joining network benefits. Israel was the first, but there are now other countries where if you become a donor, you go higher on the list. So it's the first country where non-need related criteria affected where you stood on the list. You buy into a system overall, you're part of that collection. The problem in Israel is that very, very religious people in a neighborhood, Mayor Sharim, were happy to accept organs but not so happy to give them, and the Israeli government didn't like that. Versions of this are now being tested elsewhere. In Sweden, for example, in Norway now, if you give blood or if you give an organ, you get a text the minute that that's used to save someone else or help someone else. It makes people feel like they're part of something bigger. That's compensation. I'm in favor, controversially, but I'm in favor of providing compensation for things like funeral expenses for cadaveric donors, surgery-related expenses and expenses related to employment interruptions, so replenishing wages, even insurance. I'm in favor of these big ceremonies that acknowledge publicly donors, and in all other ways, removing financial disincentives. Two of Fry's articles showed that that was regarded to be a completely different kind of qualitative activity than actually providing a lump sum incentive. This was an open letter to the HHS Secretary Burwell when President Obama was in charge, by about 150 doctors, bioethicists, and policymakers, urging her to have a more formal program where disincentives were dealt with, which is to say that the process of being a donor was brought to cost neutral. So I'm very much in favor of paying the donor a limited amount to put him or her where they were to begin with before they donated. It shouldn't cost them money. This was a bill that was put before our own legislature, and this was an article that came out on February 23rd, 2017, so almost 2 years ago. It died in committee. I tried to investigate why it died in committee. I still don't have a pure answer to that question. I enjoyed this audience as well. That was about 35 minutes, but do we have time for questions? Okay, so whoever would like, yes, Pat.
I taught science fiction, so I'm familiar with Ursula Guin, and others might know that. And one of the thoughts that came to my mind at the end of your talk, what question did socialized medicine do? Do they absorb the costs of transplantation?
Well, okay. I don't know the specific technical answer to that question, but here's my way of addressing that question. It depends on the country in question, and it depends on the degree to which things are already compensated. But in any country in the world, dialysis is going to be more expensive than transplantation after 2 years, even adding in the cost of immunosuppressant drugs. For reasons I don't completely understand, in this country, if you get transplantation, insurance covers immunosuppressant drugs up to 3 years, which is an arbitrary cutoff. To me, that seems kind of silly, because dialysis is $80,000 to $90,000 every year. So yes, in year one, dialysis is less expensive. There's really no even basic insurance plan that won't cover dialysis. That's considered, the most obvious kind of thing that is covered, Medicare and even the bronze plans. So whatever country we're dealing with, it's going to be better to have a transplantation program. But I did a little digging, and I finally got an answer, and it's a really depressing answer. And someone weigh in if they want to, if they've heard more about this, as to why we've got this awkward transition in this country from dialysis to transplantation. Dialysis is big business. There is no dialysis center that's going to, go out of its way to facilitate transplantation. I know of one of seven dialysis centers that it was even allowed to advertise respectable ways for organ donation. So whatever the answer to your question is, it's going to be better to move to transplantation.
Going back to the first statement, maybe, just having taught science fiction, and your statement, which is completely accurate, that good science fiction takes problems and pushes them into the future, shows the abuses. Mm-hmm. There have been many, many books, short stories, films that highlighted the abuses. One of them, I remember, prisoners were required to give up their organs.
That was with
to the point when you eventually get to the heart, then they're dead, obviously.
Hugh Grant was in that. I remember that. Yeah. Extreme Measures with Gene Hackman.
Is there any way in your thinking you see that this could ever happen without abuse, without the disparity growing between the rich and the poor? Who's going to be able to afford to?
You're talking about if you subjected them for sale. The current system, I think, is wonderful.
If you go for sale,
yeah,
we see even more disparity between the rich getting richer and being able to afford artificial insemination and donors and having children when they're infertile. It just, I sat here listening to all of this and I couldn't stop shaking my head because I can't see any way it's not going to create a bigger problem. The example of the military. Our military is filled with poor people.
You're speaking my words in sentence. I completely agree. I would like to see widespread aggressive campaigns, not to a captive audience like in Spain for a football game, where you hear 20 minutes of being a donor. To me, that is not the right kind of social norming. But I would like a program. My final chapter of my book, there's a section called 2 to 4 Hours. I would like there to be a program where, just like high school and college students are allowed to work in retirement communities or for the Special Olympics or volunteer in soup kitchens, I would like them to have the opportunity to sit with someone on dialysis for 2 to 4 hours and get to know all the people in that room. It's exactly how I got into this. Not because I was with my uncle, whom I loved, but because I was getting to meet all the people he got to know while in dialysis. I have to introduce you, that's Rick Antosh, who is the founder, CEO, and wonderful man behind Gold. Maybe during the break you could talk about what that is. But I want to get the acronym right. Gift of Living Donation. So he and I discussed these logistical problems, and one of my students is now working with Rick. It is a tricky thing to do that education in a way that works, but I'm in favor of the education over a quick fix. Maybe a couple other questions? Oh, yeah, well, I'll let you do it. You can acknowledge questions.
Thank you. This talk was very interesting, and it made me just change my own conceptions of the topic. So two things. One is, do you know if, well, at least very, it's great that you mentioned that those people who are in different sides of this topic, they're very intelligent people. Both sides, but do you think that those who go for putting a price to the organs, do they take our human motivation to do things, intrinsic versus extrinsic, into the deep of the root of the problem? Why people do
things? It's a great question.
And this is one question I have. The other part is that, how effective do you think, because it's very interesting they put up a solution that has to do with our economic system. Mm-hmm. Coming from Spain, health is non-negotiable. You don't put a number to that according to each and every individual. It's a right. So do they think about the opt-out versus the opt-in campaigns that they have in different countries,
okay,
how they can opt-out, and the rates of people who actually donated organs was higher than actually if you actually had to opt in. So those two questions.
Okay, so there are different kinds of questions.
Yeah.
So the first question was about what's really in the mind of the person who's in favor of also subjecting capitalistic principles to especially precious goods. I have the best case in mind, who is, again, Amy Friedman. An hour and a half we debated each other. And then afterwards I cornered Amy and I said, who do you think human beings are? When it comes down to it, and the truth came out, it is not just, as she said, that she wants people who need a kidney to have a kidney. Who could disagree with that? It's also that she's a capitalist. That she admitted it straightforwardly. Money makes the world go round, and I am just an ostrich with my head in the sand if I think otherwise. We just fundamentally disagree about who human beings are. Don't get me wrong, I wrote a book, as was mentioned, the title of which was Moral Evil. I think human beings are capable of dreadful, terrible things. If I didn't have such adorable, wonderful fiance, I think I'd be, you know, in a morass by some bottle of rye whiskey until 3 a.m. every night, just contemplating just how poorly off we are. And I'm not completely joking. There's a lot of evidence to suggest human beings are not so wonderful and that we should just succumb to our more tangible, base natures. But I actually think and argue in the prior book, Altruistic Species, we pine in both directions. And I think there is something to this notion of awakening our better angels. Introduce money, and you are precipitating a cause of events that beg to have our worst impulses surface. Not with regard to mundane things like a sofa from IKEA versus one from one of these places in Soho I could never afford, but with regard to things that can't be replenishable. To your second question, it narrowly refers to cadaveric donation, opt-in versus opt-out. So, what's your name again?
It's David.
David? So David's question, there are 24 countries in Europe for whom the system is opt-out, which means by default when you're born, the presumption is you will give your organ. And that we in the United States of America, you know, we're the inheritors of Alexis de Tocqueville, we believe in choice and going out of our way for free consent. So we opt in. We actually have to, of our own volition, state at the DMV or elsewhere that we will be organ donors. In these 24 countries, the onus is on you to opt out rather than opt in. So it's not really consistent with the American way. Sorry to make the quip about the 20 minutes before football game started. I love Spanish football. But to me, that's not the way to do it, to preach to a captive audience. But my larger answer to your question is, it's becoming more and more moot every year because of what I said at the beginning. Cadaveric donation is not the way. Living donation is the way. Human beings are living older and older and older. Cars are keeping us safer. There's a slight exception to that with the recent opioid epidemic. 72,000 people died last year in the United States, which is more than car accidents or guns from the opioid epidemic. And in New England, 27% of all organs came from people that died of narcotic overdoses. Which is, so we will get our hand as a public health crisis around that issue, and when that happens, we really will see cadaveric not be the way of the future. So to me, opt out versus opt in, it's sort of a red herring.
We are people of choosing also. We choose to give to the society. So there are different
types. And if I may, and I wish we were opt out. I wish we did it the way Spain does it. I think we should have presumptions on us by default. So. I love Spain. I lived there for a bit. I want to be absolutely clear about that.
One more.
Okay.
Great job. Thank you. I wanted to know about organ donors who have chronic illnesses. I heard that hepatitis got cured. But what about people who have, you know, like autoimmune diseases? Can they?
Are you saying can they give or can they get?
Can they give?
Can they give? It depends. So there's a couple kinds of cancers, skin cancer. Believe it or not, brain cancer. There's a couple kinds of cancers where if you're okay afterwards, you're eligible to give, but not most kinds of cancers. Same with autoimmune. Autoimmune, the issue is a little bit different. People with autoimmune kinds of lupus, for example, there's minor things like Sjogren's and alopecia areata, and then there's major things like lupus, and then there's kind of middle things like rheumatoid arthritis. And there's all sorts of other things. For many serious autoimmune diseases, the kidney is kind of delicate to begin with. I can go into it. So the answer to that question is obviously not that the recipient would be at any kind of risk, whereas that's a concern with regard to cancer. That is only to protect the donor, right? Because the donor who suffers from any sort of major autoimmune disease, anything beyond Sjogren's disease, would be susceptible. So it's only on behalf of the donor. It's a completely different kind of case with hepatitis, which is an infectious disease. I'm delighted to answer more questions during the break, and if you'd like a book, they're available for a reduced price. Just see Haley. Thank you all.